Now we're turning in our Bibles this morning, please, to the Old Testament. And we're turning to the second book of Samuel, please, chapter number 7. The second book of Samuel, and we're in chapter number 7. 2 Samuel, chapter number 7. And when we come to 2 Samuel, we're going to commence our scripture reading this morning down at verse number 18. 2 Samuel chapter 7 and verse 18. Then went King David in and sat before the Lord. And he said, Who am I, O Lord God? And what is my house that thou hast brought me hitherto? And this was yet a small thing in thy sight, O Lord God. But thou hast spoken also of thy servant's house for a great while to come. And is this the manner of man, O Lord God? And what can David say more unto thee? For thou, Lord God, knowest thy servant. For thy word's sake, and according to thine own heart, hast thou done all these great things to make thy servant know them. Wherefore, thou art great, O Lord God, for there is none like thee, neither is there any God beside thee, according to all that we have heard with our ears. And what one nation in the earth is like thy people, even like Israel, whom God went to redeem for a people to himself, and to make him a name, and to do for you great things and terrible, for thy land, before thy people which thou redeemest to thee from Egypt, from the nations and their gods. For thou hast confirmed to thyself thy people Israel to be a people unto thee forever, and thou, Lord, art become their God. And now, O Lord God, the word that thou hast spoken concerning thy servant and concerning his house, establish it forever and do as thou hast said. And let thy name be magnified forever, saying, The Lord of hosts is the God over Israel, and let the house of thy servant David be established before thee. For thou, O Lord of hosts, God of Israel, hast revealed to thy servant, saying, I will build thee an house. Therefore hath thy servant found in his heart to pray this prayer unto thee. And now, O Lord God, thou art that God, and thy words be true, and thou promised this goodness unto thy servant. Therefore, now let it please thee to bless the house of thy servant, that it may continue forever before thee. For thou, O Lord God, hast spoken it, and with thy blessing let the house of thy servant be blessed forever. Amen. And we know that God will add his blessing to the public reading of his own precious truth. In this Bible reading this morning, in 2 Samuel chapter number 7, we witness and we watch David having this wonderful yet very personal experience. An experience that is such a blessing to the heart, to the soul, to the very mind, and even to the very life of the child of God. Because what we see in 2 Samuel chapter number 7 this morning is David engaging himself with the presence of God. In 2 Samuel chapter number 7, we see David having this wonderful yet personal experience of being in God's presence. You may say to me, but George, this morning, every one of us has this experience this morning. Because every one of us is always in God's presence. Well, that's true. The very moment, child of God, you and I repented of our sin, and from that very moment when we trusted the Lord Jesus, and from that very moment when we invited the Lord Jesus by faith into our hearts, then God, the Holy Ghost, came and has been indwelling and always will indwell within these bodies in the power of His Holy Spirit until He comes or calls. I know we are always in the midst of God's presence. The psalmist himself says in Psalm 139 and verse 7, "Whither shall I flee from thy presence?" But in 2 Samuel chapter number 7, we see David not only in God's presence, but we see David this morning encountering the presence of God. Do you remember how our scripture reading opened this morning? It opened with these words in verse number 18. "Then went King David in and sat before the Lord." And encountering the presence of God this morning, child of God, is being in that place where you sense the presence of God, where you feel the presence of God, where you know the presence of God, and where you are touched by the presence of God. I wonder this morning, child of God, when was the last time you encountered the presence of God? I was talking to a missionary this week on the phone, and he and I were discussing this very text that the Lord brought me to. Do you know what he said? And he's right in saying it. God's people today have become more meeting conscious than God conscious. We've become, perhaps, and it's true, more meeting conscious than God conscious. And you know, child of God, that's what we need today. A daily sense of being in God's presence. Wonder this morning, child of God, when was the last time We had a personal conscious sense of God's presence. Knowing what it is to sit in the presence of God, I'll know it. And for the presence of God to affect us, I want to say something this morning. Out of by the way of experience, you'll never be energized by the power of God unless you engage and encounter the presence of God. You'll never be energized by the power of God until you encounter first the presence of God. The presence of God is something we all need to encounter. Job said in Job 23 and verse 15, he says, I am troubled at his presence. And when I consider, I am afraid. And I think, child of God, and there's nobody needs it more than me, we need a fresh sense of God's presence. A fresh sense of God's holiness. A fresh sense of God's righteousness. A fresh sense this morning of God's majesty. Because when you engage the presence of God, and it's only when you engage really the presence of God that you begin to be enlightened with the person of God. Then went King David in and sat before the Lord. David saw to it that he went into that place and sat before the Lord. When David went in and sat before the Lord and encountered the presence of God, he was truly enlightened with the person of God. God brought me to this text for this morning. And it's in 2 Samuel chapter 7. And you'll find it down there at verse 22. And this is what David said. He said in verse 22, wherefore thou art great, O Lord God. Do you know his first confession when he encountered the presence of God? I want you to notice, first of all, that text teaches me that first and foremost he was enlightened to the greatness of God. He says, O, wherefore thou art great, O Lord God. You know, child of God, this morning, I believe that's something we all need to be aware of this morning. The greatness of God. Do you remember Moses? If there's anything Moses was enlightened to, it was to the greatness of God. Deuteronomy chapter 3, verse 24, he says, O Lord God, thou hast begun to show thy servant thy greatness. You know, if there's anything our hearts need this morning, child of God, is to be enlightened to the greatness of God. But here's the problem. The problem is, child of God, how often we fail. How often we fail to really sit in His presence. How often we fail to take that place this morning where we can get to know God in an intimate way. To sit in His presence. To know His person. The big problem is today, child of God, do you know where we have God? We have got God in a matchbox nowadays. We've lost our sense of the greatness of God. It's because we don't engage with the presence of God. And we have allowed our difficult circumstances and our difficult situations to outcloud God. What we need in our day and what we need personally this morning is for God to explode out of the box that we have put Him in. I remember it was Easter Monday, 2014. I remember it very well. There was Tracy, myself, and Archie, along with Alan and Gillian, Catherine and Andrew, and Lexi. Lexi was there too. And do you know where Alan and Gillian brought us? They brought us up Wee Binion. Thankfully it wasn't Big Binion, it was Wee Binion. And the time I got to the top of Wee Binion, I thought I had climbed Mount Everest. I was almost legless and breathless. And I have no head for heights. And when I got up to the top of Wee Binion, I stood up and all I could feel was the air blowing round me, the wind. And I sat down and I remember looking over the whole area where I was. And I remember looking over the fields and looking at the sea and looking at the whole place down below me. And I couldn't help but think that Easter Monday, sitting on top of Wee Binion, the words of the prophet Isaiah when he spoke in Isaiah 40, verse 22, where it said, He sitteth on the circle of the earth, and all the inhabitants of the world are as grasshoppers. And sitting that day on top of Wee Binion, I sensed God's presence up there. And I sensed the greatness of His presence. My mind went away back to a story that I once heard about a man called John McNeill. John McNeill was known as the Scottish Spurgeon. He ministered in London for a number of years. And one day in London's Westminster Abbey, he was preaching to this great national service. And I remember last November being in Westminster Abbey at a service on the Friday before Remembrance Sunday. And I was actually sitting about from here to that notice board from that wee pulpit. It's only a wee crow's nest, it'd be no good to me. And I, in my mind's eye, could see John McNeill as he stood there that day and he preached on that text in Isaiah 40 in verse 22. And he said, we have the King with us here today. and the king's hair dressed in his robes and in his crown. And he says, we have all the grand judges of London here today. They're all here dressed in their regalia. And he says, we have the great military representatives here with us here today, with all their uniforms and medals. But John McNeill came out with something I don't think I would have the stomach to come out with. He says, we have the king here. But in God's sight, he's nothing, only a grasshopper with a crown on. And the great judges are all over here. And he says, they're nothing in God's sight, only grasshoppers with wigs. And he says, we've got the military personnel all here. Bless them, he said. But they're nothing, only grasshoppers with medals on. John McNeill that day preached a message on the glorious greatness of our God. And I think we have missed it this morning. When Hudson Taylor was in China, he came greatly disorientated one evening, so downcast and depressed. And he went out one day to a lonely hillside in China and fell on his face and says, O God, wilt thou reveal thyself unto me afresh? You know, maybe that's what you need this morning, child of God. Perhaps maybe you're downcast and you're distraughten and you're depressed this morning and things is getting on top of you. Maybe that's the prayer you need to pray. Get yourself away alone with God someplace. And get on your knees and say, Lord, reveal thyself to me. And Hudson Taylor did that. And he had his Bible in his hand. And he says, O God, reveal to me through thy word afresh. And his Bible opened at Psalm 48 and verse 1. And through the words of that verse, God revealed himself to him. This is what it says. Great is the Lord, and worthy to be praised. Ah, friend, do you see when you encounter the presence of God, you'll be enlightened to the greatness of God. I want you to notice that text because not only was he enlightened to the greatness of God, he was enlightened to the uniqueness of God. Because he says in that text, for there is none like thee. Oh, there's none like our God this morning. You know, once you encounter God's, the presence of God and God's presence, you'll find this morning there's no one like our God. No one like our God this morning. You know, everybody's up in arms and confused and they're worried and they're concerned about the affairs of our nation and Europe. General election, the whole thing's out of control. Listen, the whole thing's not out of control at all. Everything that's going on in this world today, God's in control of it. And God's working everything out according to his will. Don't you be worried about the next general election. And don't be worrying about Europe and about Donald Trump or anybody. Our God's greater. And our God ruleth in the kingdoms of men. Don't be worried about Europe and about Brexit and about general elections. All that's going on in this world today, God's in the middle of it. And God's controlling it. For there is none like thee.
Wonder, did you ever sit down and explore the uniqueness of God? Did you ever explore the uniqueness of God as far as His power is concerned? Do you remember Jeremiah 10 and verse 6, "For as much as there is none like unto Thee, O Lord, Thou art great, and Thy name is great in power of the nations, and in all their kingdoms there is none like Thee." Ah, friend, there is none like God this morning. He's unique in power. Tell me what other God controls this universe. Tell me what other God of some other religion that's doing great wonders and who is great in power like our God. There's none, for there's none like Him. And do you know, child of God, listen to me. God wants you to know this morning, as He is in full control of this world, He's in full control of your life this morning. There's nobody like Him. Isaiah said, "Behold, the nations are as a drop of a bucket, and as the small dust of the balance." All the nations of the world, they're just like a drop of a bucket. They're nothing to Him. Jeremiah could say concerning His power this morning, "There is none like Thee, O Lord." I'll tell you this, our God's not only unique in power, He's unique in pardon too, you know. Remember the prophet Micah, he said, "Who is a God like unto Thee that pardoneth iniquity and passeth by the transgression of the remnant of His heritage? Name me another God this morning that pardons like our God. Wonder this morning, child of God, are you troubled about past sins? There's a lot of Christians, and mind you, they're troubled. Troubled with their past. I know a lot of believers, and what they did in their past still haunts them. It does indeed. And there's times I have to sit down with them. And I tell him this wee story about Martin Luther. After Martin Luther got saved, he dreamed this dream that the devil had wrote on the wall every sin that Luther had committed. In his dream, Luther trembled, and in his dream, he saw every sin, and he saw the devil that put them there. And then in his dream, Luther saw an ink jar, and there was a feather in the ink jar, and he dipped it in the ink jar, and in his dream he went over to the wall. He's dreaming this. And he wrote on the wall where his sins were written, "The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son." And in his dream, Luther saw the moment he put the blood, the word blood, on the wall, every sin disappeared. Ah, there's none like our God as far as pardon is concerned. "He hath cast in the depths of the fathomless sea all thy sins and transgressions, whatever they be. Though they mount up to heaven or reach down to hell, they have sunk in the depths, and above them doth swell the waves of His mercy, so great and so free. Thou hast cast all their sins in the depths of the sea." There is none like our God as far as pardon is concerned. What other God this morning can say this? Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, for he will have mercy. And to our God, he will abundantly pardon. No wonder David sensed the uniqueness of God, for there is none like thee. You could say this morning, there is none like thee as far as promises are concerned. Remember what Solomon said, for there is no God like thee in heaven or on the earth or beneath that keepeth covenant and mercy with thy servants. I'll tell you something now, child of God, before I finish. The more God conscious we'll become, the more we'll be aware of the greatness of God, and the more we'll be aware of the uniqueness of God, and the more we will be aware of the powerfulness of God. Look how this text ends this morning. Look at how it ends. Look what it says. Wherefore thou art great, O Lord God, for there is none like thee, neither is there any God beside thee, according to all that we have heard with our ears. I'll tell you, friend, do you know what's wrong with the whole lot of us? And I'm putting myself in the same cot. We don't really know the presence of God and the person of God as we ought to. Wherefore, thou art great, O Lord God, for there is none like thee, neither is there any God beside thee. There's no other God beside our God. Do you remember Moses at the Red Sea and the children of Israel? And you remember how God intervened? When Moses and the children of Israel thought everything was lost, there was no way forward and there was no way out. And God revealed himself in mighty power when he opened the Red Sea and the children of Israel went through on dry ground. He didn't need to only open up the sea. He dried the ground for them. And every hoof of the children of Israel passed through. And then you remember what happened. God closed the sea in upon the Egyptians. And Moses had this to say. Who is a God like unto thee? O Lord, among the gods, who is like thee, who is glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders? I think David must have remembered this morning in 2 Samuel 7 when he was penning Psalm 62 in verse 11. For God hath spoken once, yea, twice, that all power belongeth unto God. Then went King David in and sat before the Lord. And there he could sense the greatness of God. And there he could sense the uniqueness of God. And there he could sense the powerfulness of God. May we be a people who seeks to encounter the presence of God and get to know God, never mind anybody else. Get to know God as to who He really is. For the more you sense God and His presence, the less you'll sense yourself, dear. And the less you'll sense yourself, bro. And when you get a real good encounter with God's presence, there's only one thing you'll be able to say. O Lord, my God, how great Thou art. And may God's word this morning encourage us to encounter the presence of God.